Good morning, church family. Welcome to Facebook Live. It's glad to be back. I'm glad to be back with Lone Oak and the church family, even though we're not together. Paul said, I can never take a sabbatical again.
Yeah.
Since I've been gone, everything's fallen apart, but it's glad to be here with Paul and John and this morning to bring y'all services for the auditorium. We want to be encouraging you through our service today, and so we have to remember what the Bible says, that or two or more are gathered together, Jesus says he's there with us also. And just think about the rest of all the other Christians around the world that are meeting today, and that we're a part of that. I do want to bring a few announcements to you this morning before we continue in. And we want to remember our brother Billy Porter. He's been moved to Mills Manor in Mayfield with all the nursing homes locked down. Ann can't visit him at this time. His birthday was yesterday, 3/21. Ann would like us to send him cards to lift his spirits. Melody emailed his address earlier this week. Call the office if you need it. Clara Austin was briefly hospitalized and is home now recovering. Clara also needs someone to sit with her from time to time. If you would, please call the office to get more information about that. Melody also emailed out an announcement about that and has her niece's phone number on there, and you can contact her to see where we can help Clara out. Larry Whiteloff will be returning to Vanderbilt this week for a couple of tests required for a new clinical trial. He will begin in late March. Prayers for this new clinical treatment. Prayer for Megan Shipley and Mays, and she and Andrew were exposed to COVID-19. Megan is present. They are under 2 weeks quarantine. Also, we'd like you to know that Dee would like for you to please comment on Facebook Live today if you're watching, so we'll know who's been able to watch that. If you comment, then she'll be able to know who is watching, and so please do that. To all the teens out there, I want you to know that today you'll be receiving a text from me to download a new app called the Marco Polo app, and this is a way for us to be able to communicate with each other and keep up with one another as a group, to be able to encourage each other during this time when we can't be together on a regular basis. We want John to come up now here in just a second to lead us in our first song. But before we do that, let's go to our Father in prayer. God, thank you so much for life. Father, thank you for all that you do for us. God, we are so blessed to be your children in the midst of all the chaos in the world and the storm that's surrounding us. And Father, we know that you are the calm in the storm, Father. And let us lean upon you. Let us trust you. Let us know that you're the one that is there to help us and to care for us. Father, help us as a church family to make sure we take care of one another and be who we are, to know that we need to be to one another the way that you work with us, to love each other, to care for each other, Father. Father, thank you so much. We just ask for an extra measure of your spirit for those who cannot get out at all, Father. Give them comfort and show them your love, Father. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Welcome to our services this morning at Lone Oak Church of Christ. If you're with us for the first time online, you're our welcome visitor this morning. Just join us in song at home. Feel free to just jam out at your house. We're going to start off with Days of Elijah.
Rich by the of that and darkness and
Once
Church family, as we come together at this time, even though we are not together as a group, we are still have the Spirit with us, and the Lord is with us in our midst as we come together on the first day of the week to partake of the Lord's Supper and remember us to celebrate that great gift that He gave us. In times like this, I'm reminded of what Hebrews chapter 12, beginning verse 1 says, "Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us therefore throw off everything that hinders us and the sin so easily entangles, and let us run with perseverance the race marked out before us. Fix our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of faith. For the joy set before Him, He endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand at the throne of God. Consider Him who endured such opposition from sinners, so that you will not grow weary and lose heart." So when we think about today, as we are about to break the cloud of witnesses, well, who are those witnesses? Those are the ones that have gone on before us. So when you think about this, it's those who you loved, who have were believers that have gone on. They're surrounding you where you're at today, and they're with you as you partake of this. It's not only that, but it's also think about all your other brothers and sisters that are part of this congregation. They may not be with you in body, but they're with you in spirit as we remember to fix our eyes on Jesus. That all the things that are going on in the world today just reminds us that we live in a fallen world. And even though we live in a fallen world, we are a saved people because God loved us and gave His Son for us. So let's go to our Father in prayer for the bread. God, thank You so much for Your Son. Thank You for surrounding us by the great crowd of believers that have gone on before us, Father, and help us to remember to keep our eyes focused on You because we live in a fallen world. Father, thank You for that great gift, that gift that makes us at times remember the joy that we have, that we have the opportunity to be with You in heaven at the end of times. But then it makes us somber to remember that gift because it was such a great gift, Father, of Your Son. Father, bless this bread. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Let's go to our Father again in prayer. God, we are so grateful again to come before Your throne of grace and mercy and love. And Father, as we are about to take this fruit of the vine, it reminds us of Your grace and Your mercy and Your love, because the love that You had to give up Your Son's blood upon a cross. And that blood reminds us of the grace and love that You gave to each one of us, Father. So as we take this, may we do it in the right heart and right mind. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Before Paul comes brings our message this morning, we sing a wonderful, merciful Savior.
Souls of men. Good morning. Glad to have everyone here with us, or not here with us, but here with us on Facebook Live. Appreciate you tuning in and being part of our worship service this morning. I know it's weird, it's very strange for us on this end to be in a pretty empty auditorium. There's only four or five of us here, and while I'm saying that, let me thank Carson and Clint Barrow. They are up in the sound room, and they are the ones who are responsible for making all this come off, and I appreciate them and their abilities and their willingness to help us out with this during this very strange time. But we're glad that you're here, glad that you have joined us, and thank you for doing that. It's strange when you have to do this live broadcast. You have to, you know, you're going to be live on computer screens and phone screens, so you have to show up early for hair and makeup. Well, at least some of us had to show up for makeup, and that took twice as long for me, so we're glad you're joining us anyway. I want to say to Carol Baker and Marilyn Holsworth, you two need to quit talking and pay attention. Thank you. Young mother from Michigan writes the following. She said, "It was one of the worst days of my life. The washing machine broke down. The telephone was constantly ringing. I had a headache, and the mail carrier brought a bill that I had no money to pay. Almost to the breaking point, I lifted my one-year-old into the high chair, leaned my head against his tray, and began to cry. Without a word, my son took the pacifier out of his mouth and stuck it in mine." That little boy knew that his mom needed some comfort in the midst of her storm. And I ask you this morning, how about you? All of us face storms in life, don't we? We're all facing one right now. This COVID-19, this coronavirus storm, it's one we haven't faced before. And when storms like this rage, we all, like that young mother, are longing for some peace. We're looking for some calm assurance that everything is going to be all right. That's why this morning I thought it would be very appropriate for us to spend just a few minutes in Mark chapter 4. Because it's a text where Jesus is going to show his disciples both then and now how to find peace in the midst of a storm. Beginning in verse 35, we're told that that day when evening came, he said to his disciples, "Let us go over to the other side." The first two words there in verse 35, "that day," well, that day had been a day of teaching for Jesus. He'd been teaching his disciples about, well, he'd been talking about the power of his word. In fact, back in verse 33, you get kind of a summary of what Jesus had taught up until that point. In verse 33, with many similar parables, Jesus spoke the word to them as much as they could understand. So through various parables, prior to this event we're looking at later in Mark chapter 4, Jesus had been teaching his disciples about the power of the word. So now, like any good teacher, he's going to do what teachers do. After they've taught the material, what comes next? Well, it's the test. You want to see if the students have comprehended. You want to see if the students have learned what the teacher has taught. So in verse 36, leaving the crowd behind, they took him along just as he was in the boat, and there were other boats with them. The disciples obey their Lord immediately. That's a good start, right? Jesus had said, "Let's go over to the other side," and so in verse 36, they left the crowd behind. They wasted no time in leaving for the other side. But now I want you to notice what happens. Jesus has given them orders. They've listened to his words. His words were, "Let's go over to the other side." The disciples then listened. They left the crowd behind. They took Jesus. He was already on a boat. He was standing on that boat teaching. We learned back in verse 1 of chapter 4. And so they get on the boat. They do exactly what Jesus has said. And then notice what happens in verse 37. A furious squall comes up. The waves break over the boat so that the boat is nearly swamped. So on this occasion in Mark 4, you have the disciples doing exactly what Jesus told them to do. And even though in obedience they've done exactly what Jesus said, they still run into a storm, a terrible storm, that's threatening to sink their boat. You see, I'm afraid sometimes as Christians we have an understanding, or rather a misunderstanding, about faithfulness and obedience to Christ. I think it's easy for us as believers to get this idea that, well, if I do what Jesus says, and I strive to live my life in obedience to his will, then God's going to provide me with smooth sailing through life. But brothers and sisters, let me remind you this morning, Jesus never promised that. He never promised us the absence of storms in our lives. What Jesus promised, and actually what he demonstrates here in Mark chapter 4, is not that we would never encounter storms, but what he promised and what he demonstrates in Mark 4 is that he would be with us through those storms. Pick up with me in verse 38. Jesus was in the stern sleeping on the cushion, and the disciples woke him and said to him, "Teacher, don't you care if we drown?" He got up and rebuked the wind and said to the waves, "Quiet, be still." And the wind died down, and it was completely calm. He said to his disciples, "Why are you so afraid? Do you still have no faith?" They were terrified and asked each other, "Who is this? Even the wind and the waves obey him." No matter the storm that's going on around you in your marriage, or your job, or your school, or your health, or your family, or your community, no matter the storm that's blowing around you, keep your trust and faith in Jesus. Depend on him, for it's then and only then, when you depend on Christ, that's the only way you're ever going to find peace in a storm. So the next time you're in a storm, number one, trust in his word. Depend on what the Lord has told you to do. Believe in his word. In verse 35, Jesus had said, "Let's go over to the other side." That's his word. That's his promise to the disciples. He's made it very clear. And nothing is going to stop him from working out his will. We find these words in Isaiah chapter 55. "As the rain and snow come down from heaven and do not return to it without watering the earth and making it bud and flourish, so that it yields seed for the sower and bread for the eater, so is my word that goes out from my mouth. It will not return to me empty, but will accomplish what I desire and achieve the purpose for which I sent it." So the promise there in Isaiah 55 is God's will, as it is expressed in his word, is unstoppable. Another way we can say that is, if God says it, you can count on it. If God has said he's going to do something, if he's promised in his word to do something, God is going to do it. And through his word, if God asks us to do something, he also is going to supply the power to get it done. When our God commands us to do something, he empowers us to get it done. He told his disciples, "Let's go over to the other side." Those are his words. And as they obey those words, Jesus is going to empower. He's going to make sure they get there. He's just finished teaching them earlier in Mark chapter 4 that his word is powerful. His word is going to bring tremendous results. Now they have the opportunity to see that happen right before their very eyes. All they've got to do is trust Christ's words. They have nothing to fear. If they trust Christ's words, there's nothing to fear. They don't have to fear this storm on the Sea of Galilee, and they don't even have to fear the legion of demons they're going to meet when they land on the other side in Mark chapter 5. So don't be afraid. Instead, depend on God's word. Just do what he tells you to do and trust him to get you where he wants you to go. So trust in his word, and secondly, trust in his presence. Depend on the fact that the Lord is going to be right there with you even in the midst of this storm. In verse 38, Jesus is right there in the boat with the disciples. And because he's there, because of his presence, they have absolutely nothing to worry about. Brothers and sisters, neither do we. As long as Jesus is with us on our boat, as long as we have invited him in to be our Savior and Lord, he's right here with us. We have nothing to fear. That's a promise not just found here for them in Mark chapter 4, but for us in Hebrews 13. God has said, "Never will I leave you, never will I forsake you." So we can say with confidence, "The Lord is my helper, therefore I will not be afraid." When the great ship, the Titanic, was launched, there were 16 skilled mechanics, all from the city of Belfast, and they were a part of this maiden voyage. The city was very proud of these men because they had been a part of building what they called the unsinkable ship. When the news came that the Titanic had sunk in the middle of the Atlantic Ocean, all 16 of these men from Belfast had gone down with that ship. And the city was overcome with grief. The story is told that grown men would meet each other on the street. They wouldn't even say a word. They would just look at each other and burst into tears without saying anything. Well, there was an American preacher who was in Belfast that week, and he was scheduled to speak at a church that Sunday. All 16 men were members of that church. All these mechanics who had been a part of building that Titanic, they worshiped in that congregation. And on that Sunday, after the ship sank, the congregation was just packed. You had newly made widows, you had orphan children, you had dignitaries, you had people from all over the city. The preacher that morning titled his message, "The Unsinkable Ship." But he wasn't talking about the Titanic. He was talking about that frail little boat on the Sea of Galilee that was unsinkable because Jesus was present there asleep on a pillow. What I want us to understand this morning is when we are with Jesus, we're safe. The storm may be great, the little boat we're on may be frail, but if Jesus is on your ship is unsinkable. Here, I want you to hear that. When you're with Jesus, your ship's unsinkable, but I want you to understand what that means. When Jesus is on the boat with you, it doesn't mean necessarily that your health is going to improve. Doesn't necessarily mean your marriage is going to be saved. Doesn't necessarily mean your job's going to continue. Doesn't necessarily mean you won't find yourself in the middle of a pandemic. Having Jesus on board means you have the one who's going to bring you safely through this storm to the place that he wants you to be. So we have no reason to be afraid. Jesus is on board. Jesus is with us. He is present. And because he's present, he will get us safely through the storm to the place he wants us to be. So don't be afraid. Just trust in his presence. So trust in his word, trust in his presence, and finally trust in his power. Throughout the Gospel of Mark, before we get here to chapter 4, Mark has been reminding us that Jesus has all authority. In the Gospel of Mark, you've watched Jesus exercise that authority. He has authority over evil spirits. He has authority over sickness and disease. He has the authority to forgive sins. And here in our text, he has authority over the wind and the waves. Jesus is Lord. Jesus is in charge. He has all power and authority. As the Apostle Paul reminds us in 2 Corinthians 1, we don't want you to be uninformed, brothers, about the hardships we suffered in the province of Asia. We were under great pressure, far beyond our ability to endure, so that we despaired even of life. Indeed, in our hearts, we felt the sentence of death. But this happened that we might not rely on ourselves. Listen to this part. We're not going to rely on ourselves, but on God who raises the dead. He's delivered us from such a deadly peril, and he will deliver us. On him we've set our hope that he will continue to deliver us. The Apostle Paul says, I have a God who has all power and authority. In fact, not only does my God have all power and authority, he even has power over death. So no matter the severity of the storm, Paul says, I'm going to depend on him. Jesus is Lord. Jesus is in charge. Jesus is all powerful. And because of that, we don't need to fear. Trust in the Lord, and that's the way you'll find peace in the storm. Trust in his word. Believe the things that God tells you in his word. Trust in his presence. Understand that God's with you in this storm, that he's right beside you. And trust in his power. He has all authority. He has power over all things, even over death. Trust in his word. Trust in his presence. Trust in his power. That's our job, isn't it? Our job is to trust him. When storms like this in our community and in our world brew, when storms brew in our marriages, our jobs, our families, our health, our schools, our workplaces, whenever a storm brews, we have to remember, do what he's told us to do and leave the results up to him. Just trust in the Lord, because it's then and only then that you'll find peace in the midst of the storm. Ask if you would to pray with me, and then I'm going to have John come back and lead us in a closing song. Let's pray together. God, you are indeed an awesome God. I praise your holy name. Father, I thank you for this reminder that we received in Mark chapter 4, that, Father, what you've called us to do is simply trust in you. trust in your word, trust in your presence, and trust in your power. Father, we know that you are the one who will get us through this, that we're safe with you on board. That, Father, we recognize that we have everything we need as long as our faith and trust is in you. You're going to get us where we need to be as long as our faith and trust remains in you. Father, I would pray that you bring healing to those who are hurting. Father, I would pray that you rid this community, this country, this world of this pandemic. That, Father, you would intervene and you would bring healing and you would bring whatever anyone needs in whatever situation they find themselves in. But, Father, I recognize that sometimes you cause the storm to cease and sometimes that storm continues to blow. And, Father, as long as that storm is brewing and blowing in our lives, may we find peace by placing our trust in you. We thank you for all of this through Jesus.
I rest on.